The suite of No Doubt 11-8 and Dance with Death 23 minutes and plus. When I heard that back, I thought, I think Andrew Hill would like this, and that's when I really just decided it was gonna be cool. Came up with this idea of this Andrew Hill project. I wanted to play with Andrea and Ben plus the singers. I started listening to this stuff and I said, man, I need brass, you know, I really do. And originally I thought, well, not on every tune, because some of the stuff I was thinking about didn't have a brass player, but then we just did it without the brass, you know, in my head. And I said, no, we just, Bobby's gonna be here, we gotta use him, you know. And called him, it was his 71st birthday, and I asked him about it, and he was really pretty psyched about it. He thought it was a great idea. So that was it. I mean, he seemed so excited. I just thought, man, I was kind of surprised, actually. I didn't know how he'd feel about it. Because these things can be jive, you know. You just get in there and play somebody else's music, and it's an easy handle for people. For me, it was a sincere effort, but I just really wondered what he'd think, and he was down. So now we've recorded together, and hopefully we can do some more gigs. Because, of course, he's one of the most marvelous people you'd ever want to know, let alone, you know, such a great player and, you know, such a force. In my life, he's been huge. Bobby Bradford. I live in the LA Basin, have for the last, you know, 35 years or so. I'm a native Texan, you know, originally, and went to school there and all, and probably best known for my work with the late John Carter, and in the early 60s and early 70s went on at Coleman. I mean, as far as anybody knowing, you know, who I am on records, and I've got a band of my own in the LA Basin unit I call the Motet. Bobby doesn't even remember, but the first time I played with Bobby, I was 18, and he was auditioning guitarists, and I was going to Occidental College, and we played in my philosophy professor's living room, and, you know, I was totally out of my depth, and Bobby was super kind. And
well, you know, I've known Nels since he was about 18 or 19, so I've watched him come from a kid who was really new at the guitar, and a rank beginner, to even see a man of international class.
We ended up playing together in Charlie Hayden's Liberation Music Orchestra a few years later, well, several years later, and when I was in my 20s. And Bobby and John Carter were always super kind to me and to my brother Alex and everybody, and he's just been such a major force in my life.
The interesting thing, of course, was for him to pick a relatively obscure composer outside the jazz community, you know, like Andrew Hill, to do his music, and especially since Andrew's still alive. I found very interesting. And a guy whose music I heard when he was, at the time that it was at its peak, in the 60s, you know, Blue Note label, and here now he's pulling some of this stuff forward, but using this music as a kind of propellant to do what he wants to do, rather than being just a repertory band of Andrew Hill, you see, which I find just delightful. I can still be Bobby Bradford, but we're playing Andrew Hill's music, you know? And so can everybody else be themselves. Yeah, it's fun.
Andrew and I go back, we have a trio with Tom Rainey, and we've done some duo stuff.
What I actually think he's doing is sort of using the accordion and guitar together texturally to sort of refer to what Andrew Hill does as a pianist. And I think it works in a really interesting way.
You know, in Compulsion, Andrew Hill does that left hand, like all that rumbling left hand stuff, which to me is like some kind of strange tangential relationship to Horace Silver, the way he does these like blurps with his left hand, these lumbering blurps. And I'd heard Andrew play and her kind of like sometimes rhythmic, sometimes not so rhythmic thing. And there's that low end, that growling thing, but then also she and I have a sonic thing, which you know brings to electronics to bear.
The blend is good and the energy is good, and it does do some of those things that happens in Andrew's music.
In what is not necessarily the jazz vocabulary, and I thought that this would be an excellent update of the language of the music, you know, in a way to treat it differently and not in some sort of super, you know, reverent, you know what I mean, some recreation. Ben had played with the singers as a guest not long before I came up with this idea, and he was saying, like, man, we have to play more. And I thought, yeah. Scott and Devin and Ben have a trio called Plays Monk. They play all Monk. And originally I thought, like, maybe we should be playing Monk tunes. And then I heard their trio. I said, no. And besides, everybody plays Monk tunes. And I thought, there's so many masters that are alive. Why not play the music of some living person?
I had this grant. It was from the National Endowment for the Arts. I was going to put on various concerts. And I focused on a particular composer for each one. So we did the one of John Carter and Bobby Bradford. And then another one they did was music of Andrew Hill. And Andrew came and played. And that was an amazing experience. It was a quartet, I think. Andrew, Donald Bailey played the drums. And John Watala played the bass. And we did two concerts and just had a blast. So yeah, I've always been so impressed and so moved by Andrew's music. He's just really one of my favorites. And it's, the music just has is such a unique feeling to it.
It took about 3 seconds. I thought, Andrew, man, I mean, that music, it's like a more exaggerated version of Mingus in that nobody plays the music.
Those songs will just send you in so many different directions. And so, you know, like the way Nels is approaching it, I think is, it's just right because he's taking a very open-minded and imaginative approach to the arrangements and how we deal with the songs and everything. So to me, it feels right in the spirit. Thank you.
things that Bobby brings to it is this experience, and then to just have stories about those that time and the changes in music.
So man, when we get started, we don't want to stop. So get this. They put up a red light, green light, and amber light in the sound booth where we could see. So you're playing, well, it's not ready if you look up. Amber comes when we start winding down. And the green light goes for the next guy. So get this. On the one track where it was working, I can't remember which one it was, but Dewey was playing. He wasn't looking up. He was, with the light changing, I was next. I went, beep! If you listen closely on the record, in the Redmond solo on Boy Years, you hear this note, and everybody thinks it's the time. For him. It's me back there getting ready to come in because I had a green light. So Dewey kept playing, and finally he said, better get him out. It could wind up to be like a 15-minute track. So I said, no airplay for you, bub.
And to be here and to be still challenging himself and then challenging us, and I mean, and just the notes he plays, it's just beautiful.
Devin and Scott and I, we are the Nels Cline Singers, so we played a lot of trio stuff together and done some very successful and very unsuccessful gigs together, so, you know, we've been through it.
We were first thinking about the project. I was a little bit... I guess I was curious how it was gonna all come together. It's a very interesting sort of group of people, and in a certain way there's different connecting threads, but there's not like a real, it's not like a common language.
Where we're searching and you know, no one's in their comfort zone.
And the good part of it is it worked really well because of that, because there's all these different things happening, which is the other side of the coin, you know, but it could all, you know, it could go either way almost.
Thank you. Thank you. I'm Thank you. We got a minute left.
One minute? Jeff Gauthier, man. He's the enabler. Okay. You know, we couldn't do it without him. That's it. You know, Andrea, New York City, Ben, Devin, Scott, Berkeley, Oakland, East Bay. You know, Bobby and I were SoCal. It's, you know, all faiths welcome. And Jeff, he makes it happen. That's it. It's a beautiful thing.